welcome to another Happy Pod, the only podcast that is covering Indiana Jones. My name is Nathan, and as always, I'm joined by my wonderful co-host. His name is Lawrence, and he's a scumbag archaeologist, Alfred Molina type, who will steal the idol as I heroically have to run away from boulders or whatever. Lawrence, tell us all what this silly little show is all about.
Nathan, this is a show where we get together every week to discuss something in the realm of pop culture. It could be a movie, it could be a telly show, it might even be a video game. But the main thing is that we do so without any of the toxic discourse that is oh so prevalent these days. And this is a very special episode. Tell them why.
It's Indiana Jones, Lawrence. Woo! We've been waiting. We've been waiting and waiting, mainly for the pun. But look, well, it's finally time. I mean, technically, this episode comes out on the last day of May, but don't worry about it. It's Indiana Jones, all right?
We're the only podcast dedicated enough to not release these, our coverage of these movies, as the last Indiana Jones film ever to be released is released.
I still haven't seen it.
I know, you dedicated, to be fair.
I stopped. I waited over a year to watch, and I wanted to see it as well.
You did. You kept saying to me, like, because every day it gets closer, it becomes more and more silly to do it before watching, before recording the episode. And you were like, I don't know, man. I'm close to it. Close to watching it.
Anyway, today we're kicking things off. We're covering Indiana Jones and the Raiders of the Lost Ark, more like Raiders of the Lost Fart.
No! You're a horrible man. You're a horrible man. Tell him what you did. Tell him what you did.
I stole your joke.
I've been doing it all, like, the last hour. I've been doing this joke just to be silly. Fuck's sake.
That was it. You played your hand. You was doing it too much. I knew you was going to do it on the podcast. So I thought, fuck it, I'm going to steal it from
you. You're a thief. You're a scoundrel and a thief, much unlike, I don't know,
Belloc.
Yes, there you go. Yeah. I was like, well, right, who? Not Indiana Jones. Who's the scoundrel?
I am the Indiana Jones of the two of us.
Speaking of Indiana Jones, Nathan, good segue from me. Are you... Are you a title purist, or are you a brand revisionist, Nathan?
Okay, I feel like you're putting me in a box either way.
Yeah, I am.
Whichever one I choose, there, I don't give a fuck person.
Yeah, it doesn't matter, does it?
No, it doesn't matter. Fucking hell, it's the title of a movie. Calm down, all right?
It's not a Knives Out situation where the title is objectively made to be worse.
Yeah, no. Indiana Jones and the Raiders of the Lost Ark is fun. It's pulpy.
Yeah,
Raiders of the Lost Ark. Cool, it's fine.
Yeah.
I don't care.
Interesting, but does it have that pull?
No, it doesn't. No. Yeah. If I hear Indiana Jones and the Raiders of the Lost Ark, I'm like, ooh, exciting. If I hear Raiders of the Lost Ark, I'm like,
Yeah, but who is investigating the Lost Ark?
I don't know. It could be anyone.
I'm not tuning in for your average Joe from down the road looking at the Lost Ark.
I only want to see Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
Anyway, what's going on?
General thoughts, Nathan, up top.
What a picture.
What a motion picture, Nathan.
What a picture. They don't make them like this anymore. I tell you
they
that.
They don't.
Oh, so good, man.
It's,
what a movie this is.
Yeah, man. It's fucking... I feel like we had this a bit with Jurassic Park as well, because it's Spielberg in his, like, prime.
More like Jurassic Fart.
No!
I fucking got him.
Oh, you can't be stopped. All right, let me at least say Steven Suxberg. All right, because I was going to get that. You know what? Delivery's botched. I don't even care. Yeah, I just want to get ahead of it.
It's not as good.
Fuck off. No, man, this is fucking incredible.
More like Steven Spoilsberg.
No! That's it. I'm stopping. We're done. We end here. We'll still put this out, this 5 minutes out, but we're stopping
okay.
here.
Sure.
Right, look, man, this is a fucking... This is a picture. You're right, right? I love watching a man who should have died 1,000 times over just constantly getting the last laugh against Nazis.
Yeah.
It's what a incredible concept that you can't possibly hate. No one can hate this concept.
And if they do, they're Nazis.
Yeah. I mean, well, yeah, I guess Nazis are probably a bit indifferent to it.
Nazis can hate it.
But even then, they have to commend the filmmaking, Nathan.
I don't know if they do.
No. They suck all round.
They're Nazis.
More like...
Nazis are already pretty bad.
Yeah, I don't need to... More like Fartsies.
Yeah, it's not something you need to make worse. It's already pretty bad.
Yeah, to be honest, it probably anything less than Nazis kind of diminishes it, doesn't it?
Yeah, you're probably doing them a favour, if anything.
Yeah. These jovial fart band of soldiers. Awful people. Oh, man. What a treat to sit down and watch this.
I made myself a frozen pizza. Nice. I got a beer out of the fridge.
Oh.
I sat down. I watched this movie. I had a beautiful time, mate.
Yeah.
What a wonderful treat for a Monday evening. Sunday evening? What day is it? Monday?
Oh, God. You know what? Bank holiday has thrown me off. Yeah.
Bank holiday throws me off. I think it's Monday. What a treat it was.
It is Monday. If it helps, I just checked. It's Monday.
Okay. Yeah. It feels like a Sunday.
More like, no, don't worry.
More like bum day, am I
no,
right?
Oh, no! I hate that you're better at it. I hate it. And I hate that it started with my work. Look what you've done. All right. Right. I forgot that a staple of a fucking incredible Indiana Jones movie is a banger opening.
Yeah.
Right. I don't know why, because obviously all these like pulpy things, they've got to start strong. And it's just, oh man, the build up to like seeing Indiana Jones for the first time. Like in the you're just watching two guys trail behind some guy that is obviously very capable. And they're just like, let's just follow this dude, see where we get.
Yeah. Yeah.
And like there's little like mannerisms he has, like a gun cocks behind him and he like twitches his head like a dog hearing a distant noise.
Yeah.
And it's
yeah.
like this man is, he knows what's up and it's cool. It's really cool.
He knows what he's doing. He's making his way through the jungle. He's picking up little darts. He's yeah. like poison.
Yeah, that's you know, I love the muttering.
It's good stuff. He's got a cool leather jacket. He's got a hat. I'm like, oh, who is this guy? He's intriguing. Yeah. I want to know more of him. Alfred Molina's behind him and a weird little creep as well as some other guy is like, I'm going to kill you, actually. And then Indiana yeah. Jones is like, ha, whip.
One inopportune time to cock the gun as well. Like, he's yeah. just by the... He hasn't got you there yet. He's just by a river. And he's like, now's the time.
I will say, one thing I love about this movie is 70s, 80s gun sound effects.
Okay? Yeah.
I just love that punchy sound that the pistol makes. It's just so, like, you know?
Yeah.
It's so... It's got so much bass to it, which I enjoy.
It does, or it has the other one where it kind of like rolls across the hills, where it goes, pew!
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I enjoy them all. They're good stuff.
You never get yeah. a good gun sound effect like this anymore.
No, it's all too clean nowadays.
Yeah.
It's too
like, that's exactly what it would sound like in real life. I'm like, yeah, but where's yeah. the fun in that?
Where's the movie magic?
Where's the magic, Nathan?
Where's the movie magic? They don't make them like this anymore. This is cinema.
Do you know what's really unhinged about this podcast?
What?
Is that this episode is going to be very strange because so rare are we on the same page.
It's true. Mostly we're just arguing about stuff.
Yeah.
Mostly we're just yelling about tennis and sex or whatever was going on last
and
week.
And edging, Nathan.
Shut the fuck up. No one hears.
Oh, no. We're back.
Do that again.
There's loads of little bits he does. I spoke about the mannerisms he's got. Like, just little things that let you in on, like, how fucking capable he is. Like, he gets to the... What's it called? The thing that he's stealing in the opening?
The idol or something? Just the
something
idol?
Like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
The creepy face gold thing.
Yeah, just the idol, I think
yeah,
it is.
The idol. He like looks at it, he like mulls it over, and then he like pulls a bit of sand out of his like weight replacement sandbag. He's like, no, that won't do. I'm gonna take a bit of sand out. And it's
good,
I don't know.
It's good Harrison Ford.
Thank you.
It's not everyone. It's not
going back. No, but he's cool, man. I think it's just I don't know, mate.
I think you took too much out. That idol is clearly a lot heavier than that bag of sand. What are you doing?
Well, they chuck it with ease, don't they? He chucks it to Alfred Molina pretty slick.
Well, yeah, but judging by the fact that the trap immediately goes off, it's clearly...
Oh, I mean, yeah, he does fuck it up, yeah.
He does fuck it up. It's good stuff, though. I enjoy yeah. it. I like Alfred Molina having, like, a back full of spiders. Like, all these tarantulas all over them. And he just and Indiana Jones is like... Just casually brushes them all off.
Well, he's not. Yeah, but he plays it cool. But we find out later on he's not that cool about.
No, this is what I like about it because at first he's like, oh, cool guy, spiders don't bother him. You know,
yeah.
he'll go through this haunted cave of wonders. He'll steal the amulet. He'll run through all these traps and everything. And then he's like, oh, snake. Ah! You know,
yeah. Get away!
Oh, I'm scared of this little snake. And the pilot's just like, no, it's my little mate.
He does better than me, though. I don't like spiders, right? And I freeze up if I see a spider. I'm like, oh, my God. Because I want to watch it to make sure it doesn't go somewhere where I can't see it and it's lost forever.
Yeah, spiders are fine. They're not going to hurt you, especially in this country. All right.
Yeah, I know, but
you're not going to... I guarantee you, that spider is 10 times more scared of you than you are of it.
And they should be. Because I removed them, mate. Okay. Get out of here, I say.
Do you know that if you put a spider outside, it's like immediately dead?
What? Why?
Yeah, because they can't survive outside.
Oh, no.
That's why they come into homes, so they can survive, yeah.
Oh, mate, I'm so sorry, all these spiders.
You're best off just leaving them where they be. Just let them do their thing, man. Yeah. They're helping you as well. They're going to kill all the flies and stuff.
Oh, that's true. Although I don't have many flies just lying around needing
to be killed. Summer is coming up, you know.
Oh, true. In that case, I'll put a sign on the door. Spiders welcome.
Spiders welcome. You'll be overrun.
Oh, God, yeah. They'll spread the word.
Oh, lads, this one's safe. Let's all go in.
And we could chill in the bath. They don't even care. I like a man that can do it. Can do both. A grubby little weirdo and a slick professor with his glasses, with his three-piece on.
The professor stuff is weird, isn't it?
Define weird. What do you mean?
I don't know. It's weird. It's like we go from this archaeological tomb-raiding adventurer, right?
Yeah.
And then he's just some nerd in a suit who's like, well, actually, there's the... I do, but
I quite like that he's got his like boring day job, and then like the second the class is dismissed, like I presume his boss or just like someone he works with comes in and he's like, I'm gonna steal this and sell it for money. I just like that he's a little fucking, it's not enough. His little professor salary isn't doing enough for him. So he's like, I'm just going to rob graves and sell it to museums.
I'm just going to steal cultural artifacts from their rightful place and culture and bring them to the National Museum in America or whatever.
Look, you know? It's not great stuff. I think that I like the... main thing I like about this movie, and maybe this is going to make me sound really stupid, is that it's not. It doesn't really get bogged down in being like, this is about something.
No, it doesn't. It's not like, hey, don't be bad or anything. You know, it's just a fun, pulpy adventure for 2 hours.
Yeah.
You know?
The most you could garner from it is that like Harrison Ford maybe respects a bit more of like a higher power than he does at the beginning of the movie.
Yeah. Like, well, Nazis are bad.
Nazis are consistent. They at least you know what you're getting.
Yeah. Yeah.
More like fartsies, am I right?
Orange. Oh, we've been over this.
Okay, sorry.
I love Indiana Jones.
It's hard not to.
I want to give him a kiss. And so do all his class. What's going on with that class?
They're so horny.
I know. One girl has gone to the trouble, okay, of drawing on her fucking eyes the words love you. Which means she would have had to have done that like one eye at a time, one eye closed.
Yeah.
So she can like fucking like pen it on and stuff. And then she would have had to wait until that dried to close her eye again. Otherwise it would have gone all smudged.
Oh God, yeah.
And then she would have had to do the other one as well. Insane. All right.
It's insane. I appreciate the visual gag of it, but yeah, in practice, it's one of them things where it's like, can you imagine like what the rest of her day looks like? People are talking to her and constantly like, wait, what the fuck was that?
What was that? Yeah. You just blink. You just close your eyes for a second.
She's
like, no, I can't.
she's just staring down, wide-eyed gaze. Like, I'm really sorry, I can't. It's so embarrassing.
Refusing to blink for the rest of the day. Yeah. What is this thing? I don't know if this is just like an old-fashioned thing, but what is the deal with teachers and apples? Why did you leave an apple on your teacher's desk?
It's just one of them stereotypical things, isn't it? It's like,
but why? It happens a lot, and I don't like it.
It's supposed to be like the teacher's pet. Like, you're not cool if you leave an apple. Like, you're a teacher's pet and a nerd.
Like Oppenheimer.
Yeah. Well, no, but then he puts cyanide in it, so
still
a rebel,
still a little nerd, isn't he?
I think that perfectly encapsulates Nathan.
Wash the fuck up.
I like that there can only be one class nerd as well. Like. Do they, like, if you walk in with an apple and someone's already put an apple down, you're like, fuck that apple. Have this one.
I just don't get it. Why are we giving the teacher an apple?
Hungry.
I'm hungry.
Do you want an apple?
An apple. I want to steal that apple.
I'm glad we've got to the root of the problem here. Give me the fucking apple.
I don't know. I don't know why it bugs me, but it does.
It's just one of them silly things. It's like,
what if the teacher doesn't like apples?
Tough.
They're just getting apples all day.
It's part of the job.
Anyway, give me the apple.
Yeah, especially the ones that have been rejected.
Yeah.
It seems like there's a lot going spare.
Anyway, that's apple talk over, I guess. All right, so Indiana Jones, he has to go get a thing. Porkins comes up to him.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Hey, Indiana Jones, we need you to go find this guy because something going on with Nazis.
What? Why are we like, covering this? Like, still got legs? What's happening?
I don't know.
We're going through this chronologically.
I don't know. Do we not do this?
No, not really. We'll be here all day if we do this event by event because this movie is just fucking unfolding.
All right, I'll tell you what. Marion, okay?
Yeah.
What a great character, first of all.
Great character. At first, I was worried that my opinion had changed. Because there's a little bit of like, you need to get out of this fight. You can't help me. You may as well stay tied up. But then the movie revealed that it was instead Indiana Jones who was being sexist, rather than the movie itself being sexist.
Oh, I think the movie's fairly sexist at times.
Oh, and look, it's not perfect by any stretch.
I think it's fairly sexist and racist at multiple points.
But that, look, it's Indiana Jones. You're going to get a cocktail of those things. That's just what it is, yeah. No one's cheering this aspect on.
No, it's old fashioned. Okay,
it is. But no, as a character, you're right. She's so cool and she's really interesting. I think I like that she starts as this kind of whole the coolest man ever, and the movie even frames it this way, like the coolest man ever steps into her bar, offering her adventure and you know all this interesting stuff, and she's like, "Fuck off! I don't fucking like you. Leave."
Yeah.
Which is a bit fun.
I like that she's introduced to us through this like drinking competition that she's having with someone. She's just like doing shots in her own bar and everyone's just paying her ridiculous amounts of money. They all think she's out of the game. They all think she's done too much. But then she's like, ah, trick. I'm actually fine, mate.
Yeah.
I fucking got you. And then this big guy is like, I'm fine too. And he just falls over.
Yeah. He tried to match it. He couldn't keep up. I do like that she's just openly hustling everyone there. And then when the hustle is revealed, they're all like, I'm fine with losing loads of money.
Yeah.
Cheers all round.
Yeah, yeah. It's good.
It is good. No, she's a good character. I think she's a good foil to Indiana Jones' cocky nature because she's like, she's known him a long time, too long of a time.
we're going to mention the elephant in the room.
It's dated, all right? It's just a dated thing.
Yeah.
I think a year ago Caravan covered it, and like I had to like look into some like stuff that had been said behind the scenes and stuff, and like George Lucas said something to the effect of like, it makes it interesting if it's like, you know, like a little illegal, and I'm like,
no, George,
it doesn't,
George,
it doesn't.
George, no.
And look, this is all hearsay. Oh. Like, no, this is not from the horse's mouth. But apparently Spielberg is there like a little bit older, like 17, 18. We could just leave it at that because it's not like a crucial plot point. It's just a line that they could have cut all in all, to be honest.
Yeah.
They could have just said, like, this is a man from Indiana, from Marion's past.
I mean, she very specifically does say, I was a child.
Yeah.
To him.
So they're just, I don't know, man.
And was she supposed to be like 15 or something?
She's supposed to be 15 and he's in his late 20s. When this encounter supposedly took place.
Which was 10 years ago.
Yeah.
At the time of the movie.
Yeah, so she would be 25. George, man.
Come on.
George.
Oh.
Look, it was a time of dated ideas, right? It was like the 80s, you know, like, everyone wishes things were better. And I like to think as a society we've moved past a lot of this stupid shit.
I think we definitely have, yeah. This is the trouble when you're looking at older movies. There's always just going to be some crook shit that you just got to just sweep under the rug and just try to ignore as best as you can.
You know when you see that older film logo, the studio intro, you just go, okay, there's a 50% chance some racist stuff is going to occur in this.
Oh, I just got to ignore some cultural depictions and some stereotypes and a 6'4" Welsh man playing an Egyptian character.
Oh,
like, you sure.
Tell you what, let's spare everyone this week, because next week it's pretty much all of we're going to talk about.
Oh, it's next week is very... I have not watched Temple of Doom in a long time. My plan was I was going to rewatch all the Indiana Jones movies before I watched Kingdom of the... Dial of Destiny. And I watched Raiders of the Lost Ark, and I was like, fuck, that's a good movie. And I just didn't watch the rest.
Oh, so, you're trapped now. You've got to.
Now I've got to. Yeah.
You missed out. But, I think, oh, look, I'm not going to spoil my thoughts. There's epic highs and epic lows, is what I'll say.
Like the epic highs and lows of high school football.
Yeah, you never know what to expect.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Don't know where that's from.
I do. It's anyway. Riverdale.
Oh, okay. Well done.
Thank you. never dismiss me offhand like this again.
Well, no, I usually dismiss you, and I'm usually right too. Okay?
All right. But every now and again, I have a little shining moment.
It's true. It's true. You do. Yeah, Marion's great. I love the little shoe out in the bar. It's good fun. The Nazis come. They're like, hello, we're Nazis. We want to be bad and do bad stuff. And then they're like, fuck you. There's a good little shootout. Again, more just great 70s, 80s gun sound effects. The bar's on fire. A Nazi burns his hand. I distinctly remember the Gestapo guy burning his hand. And then at some point, we see his fleshy hand in the movie. And the thing printed in it. But that didn't happen, did it?
No, it did. I noted
that. Oh, did it?
Yeah.
Oh, I must have missed it then.
He raises it up, I think, when Indiana Jones is trying to blow it up with a bazooka or something.
Oh, really?
And
he's
like, check this shit out. Yeah.
Maybe I was on Twitter. I don't know.
Stop it, Nathan. Focus.
Because I definitely remember that, but I missed it this time.
It's definitely in it. I remember seeing it today. It may not have been that scene, but yeah, he's got the kind of little
the
weird
imprint,
sigil. Like, yeah, like
and
flesh.
That's how they found the thing, isn't it? That's how they... Yeah. Anyway, there we are.
I like... There's two things I got about this bar scene, right? Mm-hmm. I like the Nazis come in and they're as much of a threat as they need to be to serve as an actual antagonist in the movie.
Yeah.
But at every single point, Spielberg's like, look how slippery and stupid these guys are.
Yeah.
Like that's about they're Spielberg. They're not ineffective, but the guy comes in and he's in a very exaggerated German accent, and he's stuttering, and he's a bit of a pathetic, snivelly creep.
Yeah.
It's very, very fun.
I like that about Spielberg. He takes that seriously. He's a Jewish guy, and he's like the Nazis. I'm always going to make them look like idiots because they're fucking horrible people.
Why would you want to depict them in any other light?
Exactly. He's great. He's great at it.
And that's not even just trivializing as well. Look at Schindler's List. He's capable of actually showing the horrors of them.
Of course he is.
And then on a flip of a coin, he's very happy to be like, watch me blow these guys up.
Yeah.
For fun.
And as he should as well. I love the... there's so many moments in this movie where it just comes down to Indy having a fight with a guy who's so much bigger and stronger than him. And he's like, oh, for fuck's sake,
Yeah.
He's just so, okay, fine, let's do it. And there's a guy who's literally on fire and he's just swinging at Indiana Jones. He's just punching at him and stuff.
Yeah.
And he's just getting fucking wrecked and pushed all over the place.
I didn't quite realize this until today's rewatch, right? It's easy to forget how, this guy is lauded over as one of the most infamous action adventure heroes of all time.
Yeah.
Right? He's arguably one of the most famous characters ever put to screen.
Yeah.
And then he spends most of his debut movie just eating punches.
Yeah.
Just people walloping him and he's like, fuck, okay.
Yeah. He does kind of stumble his way through this movie and
I love it. Yeah.
Yeah. He gets quite lucky with a lot of stuff. But he's skilled as well. There's a good amount of skill there.
There's skill to it, and it's 90% just luck and charm that gets him through a lot of shit that he should definitely die during. Yeah. Do you think the one thing I was going to say, do you think, and not in all scenes, do you think there's some dated fight choreography or stuff that maybe is a bit weird to see now that we're in a modern lens where action is often fast-paced and quick cut?
It's definitely not as polished as modern day action fight scenes would be. But I kind of like that. You know, I like that there's a bit of a roughness to it and it's not quite real. I can tell that punch isn't landing and stuff, but I'm like, it's a movie. I'm having a good time.
Yeah, yeah. The action geography is really well established. You know where everyone is in the scene.
Yeah.
So it's fun to kind of let the camera just slowly follow people. But then, at the same time, it is funny to watch, there's a little bit of video game-itis to it where, there's some Nazis that are standing there, in a minute, we'll get punched.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. They're waiting for their turn.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's role-based, turn-based combat.
There's, a moment in the the market scene in Egypt, in Cairo, where, Marion's, running through the streets. The guy with a knife is chasing her and she's running through the streets and then she runs into this doorway and then the guy gets hit with a frying pan and falls over and then he just gets very quickly dragged in. That is all very choreographed and you can see the beats in it and stuff. You can see where the marks were hit and everything like that, but it's still fun. It's great, you know?
I like those moments because that's where they offset it, right? That's where they know, look, we can't make this super clean, super polished. We're working outside, it's stressful, everyone's hot. Like, it's one of them things where they, if the fight doesn't look perfectly real, they offset it with an interesting idea. Like that one I wrote down, there's Marion hiding in a wicker basket.
That's good stuff.
Yeah, like just, but like if you can't shoot an incredible fight scene.
Yeah.
Then, I mean, there's two instances where it happens in the movie. Then don't shoot it.
Just have Indiana shoot him instead.
So, you know, everyone knows this, the age old, why that scene took place that way. It's because he was
Wasn't he injured? Was he injured?
No, everyone had, like there was, I think I don't know if everyone had the same thing apart from Spielberg. Something to the effect of, like, food poisoning, where everyone was just, like, a combination of hungover and shitting their guts out on this day.
Oh, God. Okay.
Yeah. And so Harrison Ford, like, they had a sword fight choreographed and planned and ready.
Yeah.
And he apparently went to Spielberg. And again, this is all hearsay, but, like, it's reported he went to Spielberg and just went, let me shoot him. I can't. I just can't. We got to get this today, and I can't.
It is pretty great, though. I do love, like, he does all this, like, the showmanship and the sword play and the twirl and around and everything, and Indiana just goes, oh, fuck off, yeah. And just shoots him.
And it's perfectly in character. Why would he?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
He's not in this for bravado. Like.
No, exactly. He's not trying to, like, show off and win the day or anything. He just wants to get the job done. You know?
And he like, just doesn't care. Like the locals are all looking at him like, what will he answer with? Is he? And, like, as soon as he shoots the guy, all the locals cheer anyway. So, like, what's the problem?
It's true, yeah. There's a fucking moment where, but in the market scene again, where, like, the van going past and he just shoots the driver in the head.
It's
straight out, like, Indiana Jones, like, at no point, like, no, he has to be an honorable man. You know? He has to be a man of, he's bloodlusty in this movie.
Yeah,
man. He kills so many people. There's a moment in the bar scene where there's a guy who is just, like, burning alive, screaming in pain, and then he just shoots him in the head. That's
I like to, like, picture it, and, like, watching this movie, it's fucking insane. This is a PG, you know?
Yeah, I know, yeah.
How?
Yeah, it's insane.
But there are so many, like, fun instances where, yeah, he's just, like, the easier option is to just kill someone, so he does do that.
Yeah.
And it's like, he doesn't need to be an action hero that's, like, every life matters.
Yeah,
because he doesn't care.
He does not care. He absolutely does not care. I'll tell you what, Lawrence, let's go to a quick ad break whilst we pay the bills here, and then we'll be back to discuss more Indiana Jones in a moment.
At least you're honest.
It's true.
All right, something I did want to bring up. I think the John Williams, right? Mm-hmm. What a guy. What a man.
Well, we all know this. It's John Williams.
We do, but I think in this movie specifically, like, his work is timeless and famous in everything he's ever composed, right? He's one of the greats, if not, you know, the great.
Home Alone.
Yeah, oh, God, he was Home Alone, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm.
Not composing this. He did Home Alone.
seems so.
Leave me alone. I need to focus. Did he do Jaws as well? He might have done Jaws.
Spielberg did Jaws. Did George Lucas? Not George Lucas. John William fucking hell.
All three of these men are interchangeable.
They're not interchangeable. They're just good mates.
They are.
Dirtum.
No, but something specific I really like in this. Yep, Dirtum. Incredible.
Yeah, it's about a shark.
It's a scary shark.
Do you ever wonder how many sharks needless murder that Steven Spielberg is responsible for?
Because
I reckon it's quite a lot.
It's definitely higher than one would like to admit. Yeah.
Yeah, I reckon it's...
Do you reckon there's an awkward tension between him and James Cameron at events?
Maybe, yeah.
You know, like, ocean preservationist, and then Steven Spielberg's like, go to war. Bazooka the sharks.
I think he regrets it, though. I think, like, he's aware of it and regrets the amount of blood he has caused.
If it's any consolation, Jaws is an all-timer.
Jaws is great. Jaws is a good movie. However, sharks are also very beautiful creatures, which do not deserve to be needlessly murdered like they have been.
I guess.
And also, they just, like, they don't hunt humans at all. Like, they don't...
Yeah.
Like, if a shark... Like, it's very rare for a shark to actually eat a human. Like, they'll bite a human, but that's more just out of curiosity because they don't know what it is.
Yeah.
Like, oh, what's this? Oh, no, I don't like that.
Also, that's the food chain, isn't it? Like, you're not meant to be in the ocean.
Yeah, they're not evil.
Yeah.
It's not like, is it Jaws 4 where it's like, it's the same shark just hunting down the entire family for revenge?
I think
something?
So, yeah.
Insane.
It's a simple option. It's like, stop going to the ocean. You'll all be all right then.
It's good stuff.
No, look, I like it specifically in this that the music does, like, it's so good because a lot of this, no, not that specifically. I mean more like the underlaying of the score. Like, there's moments in this where Indiana Jones is just like fucking doing some archaeology shit, right? He's just like brushing something down or like blowing on something to reveal something underneath it. He's like assessing an environment for booby traps and whatever.
Oh, like the scene where he's doing the map room and like the crystal.
Yeah, and he like lines it all up and stuff.
Yeah, that's but a like, good score. Yeah.
I can tell visually like what he's trying to do, but I don't know. Like, he reveals like a little circle in the ground and that's a big moment. And without the music, I don't fucking know that. But the music like punctuates it with like a fucking, I'll play something underneath now to like kind of get across what I'm talking about. But there's a moment in the score where you go like, oh fuck yeah, this is a reveal. And it's like, it works so nicely and so well at just like letting us in without Harrison Ford to himself being like, hey, that means that this is the thing.
Hey, that's where the stick goes.
Yeah. And like lining it up with his hands or doing something to like tell the audience something.
And then he'll pull out a little notebook and he'll look at the inscription on the stone and he'll look back at the notebook.
And he'll open the notebook and he'll write down, for those that don't know what's happening, I'm currently lining up the stuff. I don't know, man, it's a really good accompaniment. It's a great score. And it also sounds a hell of a lot like the Empire Strikes Back score.
Does it?
There are elements to it. There's a certain motif that they keep using. And like the first four notes are the exact same. And it sounds like it's going into, I think it might be Leia's theme. You know,
you're absolutely right.
Yeah.
Because I definitely noticed that at one point. Yeah. It definitely sounded like they were going to do fucking the romance theme, Leia's theme.
Is that the...
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Hello, everyone. So the plot thickens. I'm editing this right now, and I did some research on this to check I wasn't just talking out of my ass. And here is Marion's theme. I'm going to play a bit now. You know, sounds lovely, lovely stuff. And here is a song by John Williams called Han Solo and the Princess. I don't know what to tell you. They're the fucking, it's the same fucking song.
What, I don't know, what came first? This was 81. When was Empire?
80.
You dirty dog, John Williams. I mean, that's a quick turnaround, so...
It is.
And he was home alone, so no one saw him do it.
Yeah.
He was like, I'll get away with this one.
One of my genuine favourite moments, because I think it's so... It's just a great moment where Marion is in the tent at the dig site, and then the Gestapo guy walks in, and it's like a big intimidating moment. Oh, the Nazis are here, you know?
Yeah.
And he like pulls out this like... black like chain thing, and it's like, oh no, he's got like this big torture device, what is he gonna do? And it just turns into a little coat hanger.
Yeah.
it's so good,
man. But because he unravels it and it's like, oh good, is it like a nunchuck, is it like a grot wire, like what is
he gonna choke her with? It, what is it?
Yeah, or is it like, does it click together and is it like a staff to beat someone or something?
Yeah,
it just fucking takes off his big leather coat and hangs
it's
it
just
up
a little coat hanger.
Yeah. I don't know how this got started. I think it's because the I can't remember which, but like there's a famous designer that designed the Nazi uniforms, right?
Coco Chanel.
Maybe, yeah.
I think it was, well, maybe it was Chanel, maybe.
It wasn't, they should have stopped it.
I think Chanel had something to do with the Nazis. Yeah. But, like, pretty much any company that was based in Europe around that time had something to do with the Nazis, though, as well.
No one look at that year on the Wikipedia page.
Yeah, just skip past it, okay?
There's, like, a good, like, 7 years you should just blot out of your company history.
Yeah. Oh, no, was it Giorgio Armani? Who was Nazis?
I bet we're going to have to find out now. Let me find out.
Yeah. Or Gucci? No, it wouldn't be Gucci. That was more.
It was Supreme.
No, it was Supreme. Big red sweatsuits.
Yeah. And they were all saying, I'm the Rizzler. It was Hugo Boss.
Ah, yeah, of course.
Yeah. So there we go. We're just slandering two companies.
Yeah. Now, I'm pretty sure Coco Chanel had definitely had something to do with the Nazis.
Maybe.
Look that up.
Okay. We've got to get to the bottom of this.
And Giorgio Armani.
I'm just having Coco Chanel Nazi.
Yeah.
The truth about Coco Chanel and Nazis.
That's good enough for me. I'll take it.
Oh, the person Coco Chanel. If that is a person, I don't know if that's a name, but whatever. Yeah. And Christian Dior during the German occupation of France in World War II, they had ties to Nazi Party, yeah.
There you go. Yep.
Naughty people.
Naughty people. What about Giorgio Armani?
Oh, fuck. I keep closing this tab, mate. Armani Nazi. More like Armani Fartsy.
Great. Well done.
Thank you. Yeah, but the first link that comes up is seven big fashion names who had ties to the Nazi Party.
There you go. See? They're all Nazis.
Look, despicable bunch of people, yeah. But you can't say they weren't dripped.
Sadly, it is true.
No, anyway, look, the point I was getting at there is that there's this age-old idea that, like, every Nazi is super proud of their uniform, and, like, it's super, like, it's a big thing for them. And I like that he's just like, I don't know, it's a funny gag, the coat hanger thing.
Yeah, it's great. It's good stuff.
There's fucking shitloads of like visual moments in this that just like the pirate captain being like, nope, Indiana Jones is dead, and then it cuts to the Nazi's reaction, and you've just got Indiana Jones's head in the pipe.
Or on the fucking, this killed me, on the boat where like Marion is tending to Indiana's wounds, and she like flips the mirror around, and it just like fucking clocks him in the chin, and he's so slapstick and stupid.
Yeah,
he, like, it cuts to a wide shot of the boat, and you hear him screaming, and then it goes back to her like, "What did you say? Did you say something?"
Yeah,
he's like,
as if you didn't hear. Boy. Yeah,
exactly.
It's like this proper classic Harrison Ford like "Yow!" kind of scream as well.
Exactly.
He has, I don't know what it is, right? It may be in contention for my favorite Harrison Ford line delivery. And there's many that are, like, he's brilliant at an off-the-cuff one-liner.
Yeah.
Right? But just the way that, like, that guy, what's his name? The French guy following him around laughing at him.
Oh, Belloc.
Yeah. He's like, "Oh, you're going to be one of these relics in a minute when we shut you in this tomb forever." And he just goes, "Ha ha, you son of a bitch."
Yeah.
The way he, I don't know what it is, the way he says it is so defeatist, but very amusing.
Son of a bitch. A monkey does a Nazi salute at one point.
Do you know how they did this?
Cinema. That's how they did this.
I remember this. I had to fucking, I can't remember if me or Ben animated it, but I remember grabbing assets for it, right? They dangled grapes just out of shot.
Oh, really?
So the monkey like raised his hand to be like, "I want a grape." And then they just like froze and reversed the couple of frames.
And that's how they got a monkey to do a Nazi salute.
That's the ultimate gambit, isn't it?
First of all, the idea that the monkey is secretly a Nazi spy in the first place.
Yeah.
Incredible. Like, truly an incredible choice to make. Imagine writing a movie and just thinking, "I'm going to put in a fun little monkey into my movie." Because of course you are, because it's the 80s and 90s and everybody has to have a fun little monkey.
That's what it is, yeah.
Okay. But also, that monkey is going to be a spy for the Nazis as well. Amazing.
Fucking Steven Spielberg hates animals, it seems.
Well,
he's not got a keen affliction for him.
He killed all those dinosaurs too.
I know, fucking son of a bitch.
Yeah, horrible.
No, I do. I love that. I think it always makes me laugh when I like watch that and get this kind of flashback of this monkey being a Nazi spy. Because when Dial of Destiny came out, and I'll be careful with what I say, but like
I haven't seen it. No spoilers.
No, absolutely no spoilers. And there's like, but like, there's some jovial humor. More jovial humor than like is typically associated with like stoic, especially like later age Harrison Ford,
who's a
right misery guts sometimes. Love him as we do.
He can be, but he can be a good laugh.
Oh, he can be. I think he's at his funniest when he's just being a grumpy fucking ass.
I think he plays up to it.
Of course he does. Yeah, it's his brand now, isn't it?
Of course it is. Yeah.
Yeah. But I when that came out, and like there's a few kind of gags and like even like reactions to the trailer, they were like, "Why does this look so silly? Why is Indiana Jones a serious character?"
Indiana Jones is not a serious character.
He's possibly the silliest character.
He's so silly. He's a silly little guy, man.
Yeah.
These movies are very silly.
Yeah. Okay. They're inherently stupid, I think. But yeah,
this is I think there really is something that's lost these days, and people just forgetting how to have fun with stuff. And,
yeah, true.
And like lighthearted moments and comedy and comedic relief and just silliness in general being a bad thing, because it's not. You like, I know like people like to make jokes about Marvel and stuff and all the Marvel jokes and that just happened and all this kind of stuff, but yeah, you do need to have levity in your movies, because otherwise you end up with the DCEU, which is a horrible, just lifeless, lackluster universe where everyone is grim all the time and nothing fun ever happens.
Okay? Yeah, and like if anything fun does happen, it's like so character specific and they're like mostly laughing at their own misfortune and you're just like, well, this is somber.
Yeah.
I do think there's a difference in like in like undercutting tension. Like I think the reason why this comedy works so well is because it's mostly visual gags.
It's
mostly like silly. You have the off the cuff moments like the son of a bitch line and stuff like that. But it's mostly, look at this silly scenario we've concocted. Whereas like there is something to be said about like I don't think it's exactly one to one with like the Marvel look that just happened, which just like undercuts stakes.
I'm not
a
saying
lot of time.
like. First of all, the Marvel that just happened thing, I don't think that's ever actually happened in any of the movies.
No, but like, you know, that kind of brand of comedy.
I know. And I'm not saying like Marvel, even most of the time, does the humor well. I do think it loses the mark quite a little bit, but I'm just saying like humor and moments of comedy and levity, like it's not a bad thing, you know?
I remember walking out of Thor Love and Thunder, right?
Yeah.
Have you seen it?
I have seen it once.
The way you squinted then, like it was a faint memory.
I didn't see it in the cinema, I think, but I've seen it.
I remember like that was one of them. You speak about it before, like you've had opinions and stuff, and you're like, oh no, my film Twitter pass has been revoked. Like, because I came out of it and I was like, look, I know they were a lot, but those goats made me laugh, right? It's just a stupid gag. I liked it. And then I came out and everyone was like, those fucking goats. And I was like, I'll be real quiet. I'll be so silent on this.
I'll be honest. I didn't like Thor: Love and Thunder. I think it's a bit much, if I'm being honest.
I remember I was covering a channel I worked for at the time, and like, you know, ad money and stuff like that. So I was like, yeah, I'll do this. Why not? And I had
just
to
Raid Shadow Legends video.
No, this might have been another one. There were two Thor videos.
Put in just a clip now of your Raid Shadow Legends. And
all right, not a lot though. I'm not giving them anything for free.
Yeah, they're not getting a free shout-out, but just put in, just say one of the moments where you go like, and I genuinely love the way you can.
All right, look, don't say I don't give you anything on this podcast. All right, here it is. I'll put it here.
In all the nine realms, you're going to be pretty hard pressed to find more formidable fighters than those in Raid Shadow Legends. I also love that this game is always trying to expand and improve, even though it's pretty amazing already.
What a fun time that was.
Shut up. We're never bringing this up again. I had to find some like nice things to say about it, and there are some moments I think that like I think I mentioned a few ideas that the film does explore, and like my main thesis on that video about Thor: Love and Thunder was like, imagine if they did it well, it could have been interesting. Like,
could have,
yeah, because there's loads of stuff like the Thor like, I don't know, taking on a child, where like same as Odin taking on Loki and stuff. There's loads of good, interesting facets. It's just like most of it's just like seven layers deep in just nonsense.
There's a lot of silly stuff in that movie.
Yeah.
And a lot of whatever. We're not here to talk about fucking Thor Love and
Thunder. No, and we never will be.
We never will be. No.
One day, do you think we'll dedicate an entire year to the entire MCU?
No, that is right. Honestly, I think with what we have planned for later this year, we'll be pushing the fucking the threshold of what is acceptable.
We'll be lucky if half of you are still here. Like,
we'll see how it goes.
Yeah, and then there may be a hard pivot. We'll see.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, if you like the one-off episodes of Another Happy Pod that you can just drop into, see you next year, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah, it's largely series from this point out. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. What else is going on? There's.
I'll tell you what. What do you think of Gimli as an Egyptian man?
Fuck.
You didn't know that was Gimli?
I didn't know.
That was Gimli.
Huh. Hang on. I've got to look at his face again now.
Jonathan Rhys-Davies.
I think so.
Yeah, big 6'4" Welsh man who plays Gimli.
Holy shit.
You didn't know that was Gimli?
I've never made that connection. It's Salah, right? In this. Is that his name?
Maybe. I don't know. I can't remember his name. But
Yeah, Salah in Indiana Jones. Oh my lord. I never made that connection, ever.
You're an idiot.
I know. Well, I mean, he's dressed up a bit as Gimli, isn't he?
Well, yes.
He's hiding behind half a ton of hair and beard.
It's true. Yeah.
Is he actually Egyptian?
No, he's Welsh.
Oh, Welsh. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, you said.
He's John Rhys-Davies. He's a 6'4" Welsh man. And you can hear that beautiful Welsh accent whenever he talks in this as well.
I should have clocked it knowing that his like one of his names is Rhys.
Yes, exactly.
I like him in this. I think he's... I feel like I'm a little bit conflicted because I like him as a character. I think he's a fun guy. Like, there's a moment where, like, he Indiana Jones goes, "Marion's dead," and he goes, "Life goes on, Indiana Jones."
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, to live in this guy's unbothered, unfazed head.
He's a nice guy.
But then I think a lot of his stuff maybe Marion could have done. I would have liked to have seen Marion get a few more of those moments. As a pairing, I think they're more interesting.
I mean, he didn't do much, really. Like, he mostly just followed Indiana Jones around for a little bit.
Yeah, but I feel like if it was Marion following him around, they've got a better duo. They could have had a bit more interesting dialogue than...
But then who would have put on a sexy dress in the tent, Lawrence?
See, this is where the movie, I'm like, come on.
You need the woman to put on a sexy dress, okay?
I love Marion as a character, and I think, like, you know, not to spoil it, but, like, later on, Marion is included, and, like, I think their dynamic is really, really interesting and cool. But in this movie, they set her up...
She is the only woman in the entire movie, by the way.
Yes, she is. Yeah, that's true.
Apart from, like, some girls who draw in their eyes in Indiana Jones' class. She is literally the only woman. The sole woman. And everyone's like, I'm going to take her for myself. She's my prize, actually. Well, no, she's our prize, actually. We'll keep her for ourselves.
We're the Nazis, and we love just taking random women about. That's what we do.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think I do like that they do a twist on it a little bit later on where, like, it's kind of Indiana Jones's problem the entire time, that he hasn't realized that, like, oh, people are a resource and, like, I shouldn't just dismiss people out of kind of underhandedly. But then at the same time, the movie is doing that to her the entire time. There is this element of, like, there's one scene I was like, fuck yeah, where you find out Marion's alive because, you know, they had, like, the death fake out, which everyone's very quick to move on from.
Yeah, they did, yeah. Well, no, Indy's quite sad.
He goes and has a drink. A monkey. Yeah.
He's just drinking a bottle of whiskey with a monkey, who's a Nazi spy, by the way.
Yeah. he's getting sad. Intel. He's reporting back.
It's true, yeah. I like him that scene, like, because, like, he goes to see Belloc, and then, well, he, like, gets taken to Belloc, I guess, and then, like, the entire restaurant all pulls, like, a gun out on him, which is quite funny. But then just a group of children run in and save him.
Yeah.
They're just like, you can't shoot kids.
I this is why I really like about this. I think, was this Cairo? Was this Nepal? Where was this?
This is Cairo, yeah.
Yeah, I just love how lawless of a time it was. Yeah. Fucking shit's everywhere.
I think that's some of the racist stuff coming in.
Yeah, and look.
Because there's, like, also a lot of lines like, even in this uncivilized part of the world, you know, we can have a bit of normality here.
Yeah, it's not... The way it's depicted isn't good, but I think the filmmaking opportunities it affords. Like kids just running into what is clearly a very tense, almost hostage-like situation.
At least it didn't use the yellow filter.
Yeah, that's very true. It looks beautiful, this movie, I think.
It does, yeah.
Holds up really well.
Really great use of matte paintings in this movie, I think. I love
the lightning shot on the cliff.
Yes. I love those lightning shots. Like, when they're like, digging up the ark and it's, like, lightning and the clouds are swirling in around them. Mm. Great use of matte paintings there.
They did do the classic, when cinematography is good means when cinematography is orange. Yeah. Where, like, the funny silhouette kind of shot of Harrison. Everyone's digging around him, and he's like, "Oh, when's this digging gonna be done? Get on with it."
He'll just get the locals to dig for him, I reckon.
Oh lord. No, but there is. I was, like, kind of pumping my fist, thinking, like, "Oh, Marion's back. She's alive. They've revealed her. Great stuff." And he, like, takes the thing out of her mouth. He pulls his knife out. He's like, he's gonna uncut her, and they're gonna go and fuck up some Nazis together. And then he kind of is like, the safest thing you can do is stay here and be a Nazi prisoner. And I'm like, are you fucking serious?
But it's not that at all. It's purely so he doesn't fuck up his plans, though.
I get it.
It's purely for the case where it's not for her safety. It's for the fact that if she does go with them, they'll be looking for them now.
And look, I understand it. I'm not saying it's not bound in some logic. I'm just saying it's not as interesting as her coming along.
I think it's quite interesting that he leaves her there.
Okay, fair enough.
It's quite fun, yeah.
And then she has to play, like, I do like that she has to play the damsel in distress a little bit. And she's like, let's drink all this stuff. I'm so drunk. Oh, wait, knife.
Here's another thing. I remember that scene going differently as well. When they're having the drink and she's, like, pretending to be drunk and everything and they're having it, I remembered a scene where she was like, oh, what is this? And he was like, water. Because it's like it's not alcoholic at all or something, but that just didn't happen. I guess that was a fake memory.
It would have been a cool villain reveal. Like it would have, yeah, like a cool.
Like I know what you're doing.
Yeah, but... you think you're ahead of me? We've both been acting stupid for no reason.
You don't know what water tastes like.
Yeah, yeah, you're a fool. Maybe that's more of his racism coming in again.
Maybe.
No one here knows what this is, I guess, yeah.
I'll tell you what, Lawrence. If there's one thing about this movie I love, it's the truck chase sequence.
Oh, man.
Oh, non-stop thrill ride. Yeah. It's so good. Starts with him on a horse, and he's like, before it even starts, he's like, how are you going to get the fucking dog? He's like, I don't know. I'll just make it up as I go along. It's great.
That's something I think Indiana Jones is really good at. Like, it's... Like, as a film franchise, it's very good at putting him in a very tight space and going, have a brawl here.
Yeah, just let's see what we can do. Let's see how this works out. And, oh, my God, that chase sequence, that truck chase sequence, it just keeps on going. It just keeps on escalating the way he, like, makes his way onto the truck and then he gets thrown about, he gets thrown off the truck and he gets dragged along behind it and everything. He gets shot at one point as well. He gets shot in the arm.
I walk that off. Someone... No problem.
And then there's someone punching him right in his fucking bullet wound. It's brutal, but it's so good. So much fun.
It is. It is really fun. And I like that this is what I was talking about kind of in general thoughts, right? Where he's a man that should be dead a million times over, but he constantly gets the last laugh. And no scene is it more apparent where he like... He gets pushed off. He holds on to like the fucking front of the cabin of the truck.
Yeah.
Goes underneath it and successfully fucking basically 360s the entire truck. Horrible. Gets back. Then he does he makes the Nazi do the same thing.
Yeah.
And of course he dies.
Yeah.
Because he can't do the cool Indiana Jones thing.
Oh, can you imagine being dragged along on a fucking dirt gravel road though?
It looked painful.
What are his trousers made of? Because they should have been ripped apart and his arse should have been red with his blood.
Mate, that bullet wound?
Oh,
yeah. Infected. That leg's gone.
Yeah.
That, do you know how much dust would have got into that fucking bullet hole?
He got shot in the arm.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, the arm's gone then.
Him. All right, fair enough.
I'm still correct. I love that. I love the fighting an enormous mountain of a man while the plane.
Fight.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good fight, yeah. Yeah. Again, another moment where he's just like, oh, for fuck's sake, sure. Yeah, I'll fight this guy as well then, I reckon.
That first moment where he throws the punch and he doesn't budge, I'm just like, oh, we're in for a winner here. This is a great hit, yeah.
Yeah. And the guy he gets shredded in the plane fucking propeller. Brutal.
I just love the way that his blood just splats over the Nazi flag. And it's just like, hey.
It's pretty great.
Yeah.
It's pretty great.
Look at this institution sucking shit.
Marion in that scene just guns down a whole bunch of Nazis.
Outrageous behavior from her.
Incredible. just straight up uses like a 50 cal gun and just rips them apart.
And look, I'm fine with it.
It's fine.
Kill more Nazis. But it does make me laugh that she's just like, Indiana Jones is trying not to die. If any more people get over here, he's definitely going to die. So I'll just create a barrier. You can't get close because there's a crazy woman with a gun.
And then he has to save her from the plane before it blows up.
And he just shoots at the plane.
Yeah.
Just shoots the door. And I amazing. But I love the era where this was a quick fix for everything. doesn't work, shoot it.
Sure.
Now it works. It's an incredible thing. I like that it just gets progressively more crazy. It starts with Indiana Jones sneaking up, and there's a relatively weedy pilot that he's just planning on, I guess, fucking killing and throwing him off and being like, right, let's get the fuck out of here.
Mm.
And then another guy sees him. And so he's caught between one pilot and another guy. And the other guy's being like, hey, what are you doing? And he's like, shut the fuck up. So he knocks him out, gets back on. And then a big mountain guy sees him. He turns around, sees him and goes, oh, fucking, this guy's much bigger. Jesus. And then the pilot turns around and sees him. And then he's just trying to create. That pilot spends so long lining him up in his sights. He's like, I'll get a killing blow on this guy. But the mountain is so dumb that he keeps getting in the way.
He just wants to fight.
Yeah.
This guy just wants to scrap. He takes his shirt off and he's like, fucking go, boys. Yeah. Let's get ready.
He's so keen for it. And I like that it just gets progressively more chaotic. Like the plane just starts rotating.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then there's the video game equivalent of there's some red barrels. Let's not get close to them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fucking, I don't know. I think Spielberg's really good at that. Just this idea of right, a fight is boring.
Yeah.
A fight on a plane is interesting. A fight with a plane is moving is interesting.
A fight with a plane that's moving, which is about to blow up, is interesting.
He just constantly one-ups
everything.
How
can you escalate it? How can you make it more exciting?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What
a picture. What a movie.
What do you make of the ending? I guess we'll wrap things up around about here.
So the Nazis open the Ark of the Covenant and then they all blow up.
Great face melting action.
Oh my God. ILM.
Yeah.
Fucking masters of the craft, okay? The way that guy's face just melts off.
Mm.
Oh, nothing has ever looked this good.
No.
And nothing.
This is what I was saying about it being a beautiful movie as well, right? Because would I choose a CGI situation of modern filmmaking over this? No.
No.
This looks gnarly and gross.
This looks fucking amazing. One guy's head blows up. He just blows up.
Like a pinata getting cracked open.
Pinata. One guy's face melts off. What happens to the other one?
One of them... Oh, so yeah, one's face melts, one's head blows up like a pinata, and the other guy that's there, I think he just sets on fire, I think.
Maybe. I can't remember.
I think fire engulfs the screen and it's just assumed that he's dead. I don't think he's got a gnarly face effect.
I think there was. I think there was three gnarly face effects.
Really?
Let me go to the tape.
All right.
Yeah, his face kind of implodes and
okay. Oh, well, Oh, so they went for the triple whammy.
Kind of, yeah.
Yeah, nice. The three ways a face can explode. Let's explore them. Yeah, incredible stuff. I think the visuals of the actual stuff that's coming out of the fucking the Ark is incredible.
All these spirits and ghouls and everything and the lightning effect and all this sort of stuff.
The lightning effect's great, the way it just fucking careens through six of them at once.
Yeah.
And it's great staging because all the extras obviously were working with nothing.
Do you reckon George Lucas was seeing that I'll write that down.
Oh yeah, I like this.
People getting electrocuted. I'll make that blue and then we'll
oh yeah, because Return of the Jedi is the first time it's actually on, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, you fucking, everyone's copying. They're all mates. They've all got a group chat.
In the 80s, yeah, it was on WhatsApp.
Yeah. John Williams, this seems pretty similar to the score you did. Quickly removes him from the group.
I was home alone.
Yeah. Yeah, no one saw. I like the ending of Indiana Jones's arc. It's kind of this is what I said earlier, this is a movie that's pretty much about blowing up Nazis and not much else. And that's...
What do you want?
Exactly. You don't need any more than that. But I do like that there is this... There's this kind of vague through line of he starts the movie as this kind of... Not immoral grave robber, but he's definitely a bit of a scoundrel. And he ends as this... He keeps saying, if you believe in this... He's quoting the Bible and then being if you believe in this kind of thing, blah, blah, blah. And he ends the movie as someone who indisputably sees a higher power at work.
Yeah.
And it's I like the fact that he can't blow it up with the bazooka and he looks away. I like that the fact that the movie ends with him having to close his eyes and not look at something. He spent his life being imagine if I saw something that crazy, it'd be insane.
When does that sound familiar? a scoundrel who smuggles items, you know, with a heart of gold, sees a higher power above himself, but is like, oh, that's just a bunch of mumbo jumbo.
Yeah.
And then he does the right thing. What is that?
I can't place it, me personally.
No, I'm not sure.
American Graffiti, perhaps.
That's it. That's the one. American Graffiti, of course. He drives that car.
He does. I've never seen that movie.
Me neither, but I'm sure it's great.
I'm sure it's brilliant. Nathan, if you will, would you please indulge me in the return of a segment?
The Jedi?
No. You're in this group chat now, aren't you?
The return of what? The return of this?
No. Another happy question. I let it play out, but no. Okay. No, it's a segment we've only actually ever had for two of three episodes.
Clone Wars Corner?
No. Nathan, will you pack it in?
Sorry.
Nathan, it's the return of No One Frames a Shot Like Steven Spielberg.
Oh, okay.
fans of Jurassic Park 1 and 2 will remember.
Not 3. Oh, he didn't do
no,
3.
No, he did. Joe Johnston did 3.
Sorry, Boba Fett's dad.
Yeah, catch up, Nathan.
Jeez. Django Fett.
Anyway, so I wrote down 3. I'm always going to give you 3. I've decided, because otherwise I'd go on forever.
Is this going to happen every week?
Yeah, yeah. But I'll breeze through them.
Okay.
Okay.
No One Frames a Shot Like James Mangold.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, we will get to that point. Indiana Jones's shadow on the wall, completely casting just a massive presence over Marion. Great intro.
Give me the time code.
I can't. No, it's when he first walks into the bar.
Okay.
And she's like looking at the wall, and then she sees a big hatted shadow walk into the bar, No, but she turns around, she gives him a big grin, and then the rest of the scene is her being like, "Fuck off, out of my life." Yeah. So yeah, it's fun. The second one, and I love this because I think it's a creative way to do something. Indiana Jones, he's in the truck. He's finally got on the truck. He's no longer having a fight. And there's two motorbike Nazis chasing him down, right? Getting close. And it's such a simple, effective shot. It's just of his face in the driver's seat of the car. And you see him, he looks in his mirror, right? You see him smirk to himself as he concocts a plan. You see him slowly veer the truck. And all of this you're just seeing from a mid shot upwards. He veers the truck and you just hear a of a collision, and then it cuts to a wide of the two Nazis just being rear-ended into a river. It's incredible stuff.
Beautiful stuff.
It's a great little smug look from him. And the last one is that I think is a really creative way of keeping something PG. You know, we already spoke about the guy that tries to do the Indiana Jones move under the truck and just gets fucking flattened.
Yeah.
The way they film that is him, that you never see him get run down, but you do see a dusty
man. Is he
in
front of the truck?
Yeah.
Is he like in front? Yeah, because he does look a bit like closer to the camera than the truck.
Oh, look, and I will always forgive an imperfect placement for something cool.
Yeah.
And I just like that the truck goes past him. You don't see that he's there until a wheel goes over something and you just see a flailing arm and leg.
Yeah.
And it's, I don't know, man. Genuinely brilliant stuff. I think there's so much. It was hard to whittle this down to 3. There's some great shots in this.
Great. Well, thank you for your insufferable segment.
You're welcome.
I appreciate it. I can't wait for more.
Strap in.
Is it going to be when they eat the monkey brains, Lawrence?
Oh, God. I don't know.
Is it going to be when they're racist? Which moment will he choose next week?
Yeah. Is it when they're racist? The whole movie?
The whole movie.
The movie that's premise itself is racist.
We'll see.
Oh, man, it's going to be tough next week. Because there are moments in that film that are good.
I haven't seen it in probably about close to 20 years, maybe more. I don't know.
I tell you this, I'll give you one thing to get excited for.
Kehi Kwan?
Yes.
Yeah.
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 And then you watch the rest of the movie and you go, why did they put him in a mine for the rest of the movie?
I can just watch the Goonies.
Yeah.
It's a lot less racist.
Yeah, and it's got the other guy, Corey Feldman, that everyone likes.
Not Corey Feldman, Sean Astin.
No, Corey Feldman's in the Goonies.
Yeah, but Sean Astin.
I like Sean Astin too. I wasn't talking about Sean Astin.
And Josh Brolin.
Yeah, that's true. He's in it.
Yeah.
Who else?
That guy who goes, "Hey, you guys!"
Oh, the titular guy.
Yeah.
I don't know. Catch me out here gooning. Anyway.
I was literally just about to say you love gooning.
Got ya. I insulted myself first.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's the point in the show where we love to recommend some stuff.
Fuck!
Fucking hell, Nathan. What we do is recommend some stuff that we've watched, listened to, experienced, just anything that we've checked out in the past week, and we tell each other and our lovely loyal listeners. I'll go first. Okay. Do you want to go first? Shall I go first?
No. You can still go first.
Okay. Thanks. Cool. It's Billie Eilish's new album. It's a good album. You're going to do that thing again where you say she only breathes.
She does only breathe.
No, she's a very talented singer.
Does she have a song where she goes?
No, I think she's done that once in an album like 4 years ago, Nathan. You need to let this go.
I don't really listen to Billie Eilish.
That's fair.
I know three of her songs, and two of them are from movies.
Yeah, I'll give you that. Yeah. What is one of them? No Time to Die.
Yeah,
and the other one's Barbie.
Yeah.
What's the third song that you know?
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, and that's in fucking. It's not from a movie, but it is used in Superman. But he's a kid and he's evil.
Oh, Brightburn.
Brightburn, that's the one, yeah.
Huh. I thought Brightburn came out way before that album.
No, it didn't.
Hang on, they played Bad Guy in the movie where What If Superman Was a Bad Guy?
Yeah, they played it in the credits.
Fuck's sake.
Like, the movie ends and then you just hear Billie Eilish going, "I'm the bad guy."
For fuck's sake.
Yeah.
Awful behaviour.
Good movie.
I haven't seen it, to be fair. So
there you go. Judging it.
I know, I shouldn't do that. That's naughty of me.
Just like film Twitter.
Ah, he's got me. He's caught me. He's finally boxed me in. Anyway, Billie Eilish's new album is called Hit Me Hard and Soft. It's nice and breezy. It's quite a short album. I think there's only like 7 or 8 songs. And if you're not a big music listener like me, I appreciate a concise album like that. Just get in, get done, have a good time. Which I like. It's speaking quite openly about her sexuality, which is really nice, and it's interesting, and it's a good, I think, a good piece of art, and also just bops, which is what you want from an album.
I guess that is true.
Yeah, it'd be a bad album if there were no bops.
That is true.
Yeah. Anyway, what are you recommending?
I am recommending New Girl.
Oh, okay. I'm sure you've done this before.
I don't think so.
Either you have or I have.
I definitely haven't. But specifically, the best episode of New Girl ever.
Okay.
Because it's one of those episodes that I can just throw it on whenever, and every single time it is just perfect.
Yeah.
It's just so many laughs. It's just the perfect encapsulation of that show. You get so many incredible comedic moments, such great performances from all the characters. Largely just one setting for the entire episode.
Can I guess?
So fucking good. You can. I'll give you 3 guesses. If you get it wrong, you're fired.
Okay. All right, first guess. Is it the episode where they think they have to hide a bag of meth?
Yes.
It's an incredible episode,
isn't
it?
It's so good.
Yeah.
Background check.
Yeah.
Series 4, episode 13, I want to say. I might be wrong, but it's somewhere around that mark. Oh, it is just the perfect episode of New Girl.
Yeah.
It is so fucking hilarious.
That moment when Nick, Nick, you need to block your ears out. And you go, "Turn the love and take it down."
I can see your lips moving. Well, close your eyes. It's so good. Basically, the premise is Winston is applying for to be a police officer in the LAPD, and like an officer from there has to come and interview his like roommates and everything, and because everyone's a bunch of weird kooky characters, just everything goes wrong. It just drama ensues. And I love when Coach is like, you say he's Winston, is like looking after he's part of like the Big Brother program.
Oh, yeah.
And then he says, I'll go get him. And then he realizes that he has to go and get like a 12-year-old boy called Daquan, which he just made up, and bring them back. And then he's just like, "Does anyone want to come with me?" And everyone's like, "No."
And he shows up to this fucking guy's van. And like, he shows up to like a kid's park and he's got a van and he's like, hey, one of you guys. And then he clearly brings like, home a 20-year-old or something.
He brings like, it's like a 30-year-old Mexican guy.
Who's just small.
It's so good. Who's clearly just like a day worker.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
But it's so funny. It's just the perfect episode. Everyone is hilarious. Max Greenfield is always fucking hilarious.
He's phenomenal in that show.
This is the one where it's like CC is dating a guy called Paul. And he's like, Paul, how do you pronounce that?
Max Greenfield, I always say this, right? Like, he should be largely regarded as one of the greatest to ever do it in sitcoms. Like,
he is.
He's so funny. He should have like the type of kind of name recognition that that a fucking what's his name? I know that's very ironic. Ron Swanson, I've forgotten his name.
Oh, Nick Offerman.
Nick Offerman, that's it. Yeah, like yeah. Nick Offerman, Aziz Ansari, like he should have those levels of heights, but like I guess not enough people have seen New Girl.
It's fairly
popular, but it's not The Office and Parks and Rec. Like
No, I don't think it is. Yeah. No. But it deserves to be because it's so good.
I think it's my favorite of all of them.
Yeah, I think it's probably the most rewatchable.
Yeah.
It's such a good show. I love it so much. 29? It's great.
Right, thank you very much for listening, everyone. If you've enjoyed the show, please feel free to leave us a 5-star review. It would be very much appreciated. Ooh. You can also follow us on Twitter at Another Happy Pod, where you can suggest a topic for us to check out. Be sure to join us next week because we are going to be continuing Indiana Jones and checking out this.
The old legend of the Shankara stones. The villager's sacred rock was taken.
Village stories, Dr. Jones.
It's the next one. It's the racist one.
It is the racist one, yeah. Also, if you want to support the show, we do have a Ko-Fi link in the description. Obviously, feel no pressure whatsoever. It's just a nice way to tell us that you care.
For the score, it does say still got legs, just because that's like the most popular podcast. Yeah.
We're doing branding, okay?
Yeah.
We're trying to do some SEO business on here.
But you can support us too.
Yeah. If you're into it, if you're not.
If you're into it, absolutely no pressure. Support what you can from as little as a pound, and any support is appreciated. We thank you.
And you're also welcome to just ignore that and stay here.
100%.
Yeah. Nathan, we have another podcast as well, speaking of.
We certainly do. It's called Still Got Legs. Whoa. It's our Doctor Who rewatch podcast where every single week we watch and discuss an episode of Doctor Who. And if you love Christmas in the middle of summer, then boy, have I got a treat for you next week. This week? Last week? I can't remember. I always get confused. But at some point, we will be discussing the 2010 Christmas special, which is A Christmas Carol. A good, festive, fun time. So get involved.
Indeed it is. Anyway, thank you very much for listening again. We will see you next Friday at 10 a.m. Stay sexy, stay cool. Nathan, play us out with some John Williams Fire.
You got it.